you are what you are in this world. That's either one of two things. Either you're somebody or you're nobody.
A lot of this is behind the scenes or under the hood.
It's time to just look under the hood. No stone should be unturned.
I don't even know what that means. Look under, I got an engine underneath my hood.
Most important thing in business is honesty, integrity, hard work, family. Never forgetting where we came from.
Hey, pop the hood.
Pop the hood?
Pop the hood.
Welcome to the Under the Hood podcast with Jonathan Hood. Across 110th Street, pushers won't let the junkie go free. Across 110th Street, woman trying to catch a trick on the street. You bet it.
I told him if I didn't get what I wanted, I'm out. Full stop.
And?
He said Jacob could be AP.
Yes.
See?
See what?
Oh, nothing. Just thank you.
What about me? He wouldn't do it. I'm sorry.
So how come you still have a job?
Because, well, that was the deal, right? Give me Jacob and Charity, or I'll walk.
Well, it seemed like once he said...
How come you're not walking, Grace?
Charity, once he said yes to the idea of Jacob, it didn't seem right to just continue...
Oh, so you didn't push for me at all?
I pushed as much as I could. And then when it stopped making sense, an idea you might not understand.
So why Jacob and not me?
Jacob's led a church, Charity.
Oh, so you won't... Gigi's side, now that you're getting everything you want.
Oh, my. Oh, here goes crazy.
You know what? I will whoop your ass, Dream Baby.
Bring it! Butter,
me! Really?
No, stop. Both of y'all, stop.
None of you care about me.
Would you please stop catastrophizing?
Not one of you has walked over to hug me or to say, sorry, Charity, I know this hurts.
If you would just be quiet and have your feelings instead of spraying like some loose fire hose, maybe we could.
Yeah. Just watch.
Oh, Charity, please, just sit down, okay?
Why? Why? Because y'all the ones that's gonna get this church back. Because y'all the 18? Well, when it's all said and done, you wanna know who's gonna be preaching and teaching and reaching for every possible star from behind that pulpit? Me! Mm-mm. Go ahead and laugh, Carissa.
Huh? What?
I'm the one that's bringing dignity back to Calvary. Ain't that right, Daddy?
Yes, baby, but don't run.
Pastor, Charity, Greenleaf. Because God is good. All the time.
This morning.
Welcome to the Under the Hood podcast. I'm Jonathan Hood. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter, twitter.com, tweetjhood, on Instagram, IGJHood, and also on Snapchat, snapjhood. That's where you can find me on social media. Also our Facebook page, facebook.com. Well, of course, we're on weeknights at 7 here on ESPN 1000 and the ESPN app. Always catch the shows there. And also, if you're a wrestling fan, Tuesday Wrestling Tuesday, every Tuesday night at 9:30 on ESPN 1000, as we're on between 7 and 10 Central Time in the evening. And if you don't catch that, you could always check out the podcast as well. Tuesday Wrestling Tuesday has its own podcast. So glad that you are with us here for our special conversation with Deborah Joy Winans, the Detroit native who is from the famous gospel family, the Winans. Man, they have been such a blessing and such a joy over the years, not just a few years, for decades. They have been able to provide a lot of great gospel music. But Deborah Joy Winans is different than CC and BB and some of the other great Winans that have been able to sing gospel music. Deborah has found her own path as an actress, and also she does some singing. As a matter of fact, someone like Deborah Joy Winans really wasn't into music. She was into doing other things, and now she's been able to have her own hit single, When I Rose. It's in our archives there. You can find the description right there. Deborah Joy Winans, When I Rose. You can download that on Apple Music, iTunes, Spotify, wherever you download your music. We ask you to support her because she supported us being on the program. We talked to Deborah about a number of things. We talked to her about her career as an actress on the hit show Greenleaf. That show airs on the OWN network, O-W-N, that is the Oprah Winfrey Network. It is a tremendous show that I watch, as well as our executive producer, Sean Davis. We watch it weekly. It's a very interesting show. Check that out, weeknights. It is called Greenleaf. And she plays the character Charity Greenleaf Satterley, a very complicated character that's had a lot of things going on in her life. The show is in season 4 as we record this. We talked about her as an actress. We talk about her experiences, things that she wants to accomplish, and the difference between Baptist churches, white Baptist churches and black Baptist churches, as well as talking about what we can expect for season 4 of Greenleaf. Deborah Joy Winans, a pleasure, with us on the Under the Hood podcast. I just want to find out from you, Deborah, how's life? How's life for you right now on this very, at this very second?
At this very second, life is wonderful. I have no complaints. Look, I'm breathing, okay?
Mm-hmm. Right. Nothing wrong with that.
Right? With that.
Absolutely. Well, I just want to know, I just want you to know, just first and foremost, that my family and I, we really enjoy Greenleaf, and again on the OWN network, as we talked about, we really love it. And so, I do have a lot of questions though about the show, so I'm going to ask you this. First, I just want to know how much fun you're having with Greenleaf, because we're watching the show, but we can tell that you're really enjoying the character.
Oh my goodness, it's a blast! It's so much fun to be bad. Oh my goodness. I'm thrilled anytime I get to do what it is I love, you know, what it is I have a passion to do. And so I'm very grateful. And this season was just a lot of fun for me.
Yeah, and it's a lot of fun for us to watch. And we watch weekly, by the way, as God intended, not on demand, weekly, because we love the episodic nature of the show. We're not going to binge watch Greenleaf. That's one of these things where you need to be able to watch it, watch the episode, and then talk about it and text about it and tweet about it, and then wait till the next week, because that's a thing. That's an absolute thing for us.
Yeah. I love that.
Yeah, so I want to know... Charity Greenleaf Satterley, and you know I'm into the show if I know your married name.
Right, if you know that married name from the ex-husband. Yes, you are.
Deborah, I got to ask you about this latest episode. I don't think I'm giving away spoilers. If you have not watched the show, you've got to be able to watch it, because it's so intriguing and so thought-provoking, Greenleaf. So this week's episode is episode 4, and... And it's you on stage singing with the white lady from Harmony and Hope. Now, let me just tell you, I had to take a knee because I was just cracking up, because it just shows you how well shot this show is. The first thing you see is the banjo. And when you see the banjo, you know that's not black at all.
You know. So, you already know you are in for a very Caucasian experience.
So the camera pans out to you and the white lady. In this particular storyline, you do not want to sing this song. You have tried to find a way to have a gospel spin to it. You know, try to do something to it, and it just won't work. So what was that scene like, you singing side by side with the lady?
Oh, my goodness. The amount of times we cracked up and had to start over, because it's so not Calvary. It is so not what Charity is used to. It's not what anyone is used to at that church. And the young lady playing Judy is so incredibly funny. And so we had so many moments where we could not hold it in, because we knew how ridiculous it was. But it's also uncomfortable. it's very uncomfortable. And I think that you see the discomfort in the Greenleafs and just in the people of Calvary, and the discomfort of Charity after the song where they pan up and she's sitting between the banjo player and Judy Whitmore. It is hilarious because, you know, they are not where they want to be. And so it's uncomfortable, but it's hilarious. It's funny. It's exciting. And it makes you wonder what they're going to do because, you know, Charity can't take that. It
no,
can't end that
not.
Way.
No, absolutely. Absolutely not. I got everything in that scene except Daddy sang bass and Mama sang tenor. You will get that from a white Baptist church every day. And you know what? I think we need to distinguish the difference because I think that, you know, because you've been around it for such a long time, there is a distinct difference between the white Baptist experience and the black Baptist experience in church.
Oh, absolutely. Can you
tell people the difference?
Absolutely. I mean, one has movement and one doesn't. One has a sort of freedom, and one is very conservative, very contained. You know, one has the talk back. We will always talk back to the preacher, to the worship leader. We'll move. We might take off shouting because the spirit done hit us. But you don't really see that in the Caucasian Baptist experience. And so they're very, very, very different. And they had to sort of take down their black experience in the church and try to meld it with this very, very, very Caucasian experience. And nobody is understanding how to handle that.
Okay, so Deborah, tell me this. Without any spoilers, can you just give us a little hint? Will there be some white people catching the Holy Ghost on Greenleaf? Will we see that weird thing where when they catch the Holy Ghost and we catch it, it's a little bit different. You know, they look like they're being, you know, a cattle prod. They've been shocked. Which is a kind of a weird thing. I know
Jonathan,
we catch a spirit differently, but I'm just wondering.
You know, I think that you will see the true heart of some people. And, you know, you recognize church is for everyone. And you will see people trying to mix and mingle and see how that works out. Mm-hmm. It's really just going to be about how the Greenleafs are able to sit in this situation, this very uncomfortable situation, and watch these Caucasian people try to take what is supposed to be the black experience. And there are going to be some moments that are really going to tickle you in a in a fantastic way, in a very gut-wrenching, laughing way. And then there are going to be some moments that you're going to be like, if you don't get your white self out of here, it's going to be a lot.
Right.
It's going to be a lot. You heard Charity. This song is... it sounds like sin. It's the whitest piece of ear trash I've ever heard. You know, she's going to express her mind, and it's going to be fantastic.
Yeah, it absolutely is. It's the own network, Greenleaf, that airs. If you have not watched it, you should download it. You should make sure you check out the episodes of Greenleaf as Deborah Joy Winans with us on the Under the Hood show here with Jonathan Hood. Your character, for those that are not familiar with Charity Greenleaf Satterley, boy, Deborah, I don't know if there's been someone that has gone through so much in such a short amount of time.
But the story
has been very well told. It was not rushed because it's I like the way that we get a chance to know who Charity is, even though she may not know herself. What do you think of the character that you're portraying?
Oh, I love her. I love Charity. And kudos to our creator, Craig Wright, and our showrunner, Chris Turner Towner, for really taking their time to develop who this young woman is. I love her because she's real. She's been through a lot. I think that there are quite a few women out there who may have taken the plunge, gone down the aisle with someone that ended up, you know, figuring out their true self was not to be with a woman. And so she had to find that out at the height of her pregnancy with twins. And that's devastating. And she loses a baby. And she has a baby, so she has to deal with the loss of a child, the loss of a marriage, the birth of a child, where she stands. You know, what does that do to a woman finding out that her husband doesn't even want anything that she has? That's her husband, her best friend, and she loses that. And I think she loses a sense of herself. And she's in this family that doesn't really see her. She's very invisible to them. Every time she says she wants to do this, she wants to do that, it's, oh, no, just go sit down. This is what you do. This is all you do. And so she's very limited to her family, and she just wants to break out and really be who she feels she's called to be. So there's a lot happening in her life, and she tries to stick to what they say, and it's still so hard. It's rejection after rejection after rejection. There's grief, and then when you don't take time to deal with the grief, it's pent up somewhere. It's gonna come out somewhere, and it comes out in season three with her drinking and her oxy situation. She's just looking to relieve the pain some way, somehow. And Dr. Van Zandt comes in and kind of gets down to the nitty gritty. She gets down to what's really going on with Charity, why she's acting out, how she's really feeling. And it just comes down to feeling invisible, feeling unloved, feeling unseen, feeling like they just want to put baby in a corner. And she's tired of being in that corner. And so when we get to season four, she's making decisions, and albeit they may not seem like the right decisions, the fact that she is a woman who knows what she wants, and she's no longer satisfied just being told to go to the corner and do what they tell her to do, I love. And, you know, she's going to have to take responsibility for some of the actions that she takes, but that's fine. Take responsibility, but do something. And I love that about her. She is doing something. She's not just sitting around living a life that everyone else thinks she should live. And I think that she'll figure it out sooner or later, but I love it because I think that that's real. I think that we don't always have the right answers, but I think that we need to see someone at least making a decision to move and not to just be what everyone else thinks that she should be.
Yeah, such a powerful character, Deborah. Charity Greenleaf, Saturday. Oh, by the way, so I had Joseph Sikora on the program, the actor called Tommy on the show Power. And he's from Chicago, so we had him on. We was talking about the Bears and talking about his career. And I asked him, I said, how many people call you Tommy when you're just going around and you know, going around the cities and people recognize you? He goes, I don't mind people calling me Tommy. I want them just to respect me and enjoy the show Power. And I'm like, okay, that's cool. So how many people call you Charity?
Oh, everybody.
Everybody?
Yeah, everybody. Everybody. It's either Charity or, aren't you a Winans? And so, but I love that because it tells me that, number one, they watched the show. It tells me that they like my character, or even they dislike her, but she's done something to be on their mind. And so I love that they care some sort of way about her. And that's what you want. You want people to watch, you want people to feel. And so I don't mind. That makes me happy. What becomes interesting is if I'm, you know, out with my husband and they come up to me saying, girl, your husband might not have been gay. You ain't give him a chance. And I'm like, wait 1 minute. Now, my husband is not. Now, you want to talk about Charity? Charity, yes, she probably could have given him a little bit more of a chance. But he, you know, he made his choice. He is doing what he wants to do. Now, my husband, however, is, we have no questions.
Yes.
And so you have to help them sometimes make the difference. You know, they've even said, ooh, where your baby at? I have not had a baby. You look good after having your twins, girl. I have never been pregnant. So, you know, you help them understand the difference between life and the TV show. But you don't. I never mind when they want to talk to me or they call me Charity or, ain't you a Greenleaf? It's all good. That means you're watching. That means you're enjoying. That means you're into something that we're doing. And possibly we're making an impact on you. And that's what you want to do with your art. So that's exciting.
That blurred lines thing, Deborah, is really interesting because Sakura said the same thing. He goes, you know, listen, I'm not trying to fight ghosts when I'm not on the set. I'm not trying to go after 50 Cent. We're not gonna kill him, like, for real. You know, it's weird.
It's not real. It's not real life. But you know, people get so into it. They get so into the story, especially if it's well written, and they get so excited about it. And you realize that people are just kind of overwhelmed when they see someone they've been watching on TV and they're so into that story. And then it's like, oh, and they have so many things that they want to say. They're not necessarily thinking about the difference between who you actually are in real life and what that story is. And so, you know, you recognize that and they're excited. But it's fun. It really is fun.
Deborah, I see that you have a single out, When I Rose. I heard it on Apple Music, and I know I can get it on Spotify and Amazon Music and YouTube.
Yes.
And wherever you download your sound, you can be able to find Deborah Joy Winans' When I Rose. I find this interesting because of the ebb and flow of your career as someone that is an actress, not necessarily seeking to sing, but you felt the need here. What gave you the feeling to be able to sing When I Rose here?
Well, we do the original version of this song in the show this season. And the music producer that we had for this season, Derek Thornton, who is really amazing, he was just like thinking of different soundtrack ideas with the songs that were on the show this season. And he was like, how do you feel about doing this, but flipping it, you know, for our generation, for people that are not necessarily into the traditional gospel, but it's such a dope message. It's such a wonderful feeling. And, you know, why don't we create something that can just be a vibe for the younger people? Because you want everybody to understand the goodness of God and just how great he is, but sometimes you got to flip it in a different way for a different generation. And so that was the feeling behind that. And I just didn't realize Lionsgate would love it so much. They really loved it. They were really excited. I had a lot of fun doing it because you want to hear things that you want to hear as well. And I wouldn't necessarily just be jamming to the original version. I think it's an incredible song. I think it's a staple in the gospel community. But in my car today, you have to think sometimes, like at my age, what's the sound that I want to hear and how can we sort of continue to revive songs that have such a great message and mean so many great things? And so I just thought, okay, this is really dope. Let's do this. And I had no idea where it would land, but Lionsgate loved it. And I'm still working on what my sound actually is. I've never wanted to sing, and doing this show has really opened my eyes to the idea that whatever gifts God has given me, they're not for me. So if he's given me a gift to sing, I need to use it, because it could be beneficial for someone else. And so I'm like, okay, well, if I sing, I want to sing things that mean something to me, that that are real to me. And so this song is very, very real to me. And so it's like, okay, well, why not? So I don't know if there's a full EP coming of sorts, but I'm certainly open to doing a little bit more music that I feel like can come from my soul and from my heart, because that's the only way it's going to penetrate anyone else's heart.
Again, it's When I Rose, wherever you download your music. I did it on Apple Music. You can do it on Spotify, iTunes, also on Amazon Music and YouTube, Deborah Joy Winans, When I Rose. As we have our conversation, download that song. We really appreciate that for sure. You just never know, Deborah, when God's grace is going to come about, because you could pray for something and you just don't know when it's going to happen. You pray for it and mm-hmm. you have that relationship and that connection to God, so you don't know when it's going to happen. So, but for you, mm-hmm. the story is interesting with you being able to meet Oprah, because Oprah's name is as big as Michael Jordan's in this city still, and she doesn't even have her show here anymore, but it's still a huge name here. But I'm interested if you could tell our audience the first time that you were able to connect with her to be able to get this role as Charity Greenleaf.
Oh, absolutely. It is one of the greatest moments in my life. I will never forget it. I will always honor her. She's so, so incredible. I was doing a workshop for my Uncle BB's musical. It's a story about his life called Born for This, the BB Winans story. And we did a workshop in New York in March of 2015. And Oprah was there, Gail was there, Cicely Tyson was there. Mm-hmm. It was quite a surreal experience. And so we did the workshop. It was a fantastic night. And then that was that. And so 2 months later, it's just, I got my undergrad, my BFA, my MFA in acting. I studied for a month at the Moscow Art Theater School. Like, acting is my dream. It's my passion. I have done my training. It's all I've pursued. And I've gotten so many no's at this point. And so I think I was just sort of discouraged. And a couple months after that, I was sitting at home in L.A., and I was just praying, and I said, God, if this is what you have for me to do, then I need you to open a door, because every door is just kind of closing in my face. I have no agent. I have no manager. And that was my prayer. Literally the next day, my uncle called me and said that Oprah had just called him, and she was reading this show and couldn't get me out of her mind, and wanted me to email her my headshot and my resume. And I thought, oh my goodness, okay. And so I did that, and she responded and asked for my phone number. And then she called me, and she told me the little bit she could about Greenleaf. And she said, I could not get you out of my mind for this particular role. And I mentioned you to the network, and unfortunately, no one knows who you are. And I just said, they wouldn't. Because I haven't done anything.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Literally done nothing. And she said, it's okay. I just believe that they will see what I see when it's time for you to audition. Mm-hmm. And I will open the door for you as wide as I possibly can. And if I never booked Greenleaf, that phone call, those emails were just a confirmation to me that I was on the right path, and I just needed to stay focused, stay consistent, and stay prepared. And so that was quite incredible to me. And then I auditioned like 3 weeks later, and then I got it. And I was walking out of Trader Joe's on Vine between Sunset and Hollywood when they called me and told me I got it. And I was crying on the street. And my brother was in town, and he was telling random people walking by, she just booked a role. Like, it was the funniest, most amazing moment. And to have Oprah Winfrey as my cheerleader, as the one championing me to all of these people, all of these executives at Lionsgate and OWN, I just wanted to get there. I wanted to show up, and I wanted to do what I know I needed to do so that she could feel good about that gut decision that she had about me. And that's what we did. Got there, and she is the greatest. She's everything you think she is on TV. She is fun. She's kind. She cares. Mm-hmm. She's just a real person, constantly ready to work and constantly ready to help others. And so that's what we did. Once we shot that first table scene, She was like, oh, that was it. They did my close-up. She was so happy. She came to me in tears. That was it. That was it. We're good. And so I think that I know that I will never forget these precious moments that I've been able to spend with her, because it's not only just made me a better person, but a better actor. I understand, you know, a woman, we are on the Oprah Winfrey Network, mm-hmm. and when it's time for her to shoot, she is there before time. She is dedicated. Her work ethic is phenomenal. And so if you just sit and observe, there are so many things you can learn from Oprah Winfrey. And the greatest thing that I took away from working with her is that the love is in the details. Nothing goes by without her fully looking at what's going on, how does this affect everything. She really, really loves what she does. And because she loves it, she watches every detail. And that's incredible to me. She's at the top of my list. I praise God for her, and she knows this.
Wow, that's so powerful. What a testimony.
Absolutely.
It really is. And as you mentioned, she's just like how we see her on television, right? I mean, just
absolutely.
That first phone call when you heard her voice, what did that sound like?
Oh my goodness. So it said unknown, and I looked at my husband. I said, "Do you think it's her? Do you think it's her? This can't be her." He was like, "Pick up the phone." and so I said, "Hello?" And she said, "Deborah Joy, it's Oprah Winfrey. How are you?" And I said, "Oh my God."
That's a great Oprah.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, it is surreal. It really, really is. And she makes you feel so comfortable, which is wonderful. But I never want to get too familiar that I forget that this woman has literally changed the course of history for our culture, for our community, around the world. She's done so many. She is an icon. She is a legend. She is a treasure. And you never want to forget that. You always want to honor her in that way.
Deborah and Deborah Joy Winans with me, Jonathan Hood, on the Under the Hood show right here where you download your podcasts. So, Deborah, I just happened to just be looking on shopjboland.com, and I see you modeling a lot of these great outfits. Let me give my church fan, as I ask you this question, holy blank. So I'm just wondering, when did you start going into modeling? Because that's fire.
So, okay, thank you. I have always loved modeling. I've always loved fashion and beauty. And my mom put me in modeling and finishing school when I was growing up. And I did that for 7 years, and I totally loved it. But then as I got into college, I wanted to focus on my passion of acting. But I've always wanted to model. It was just, it seemed a little bit hard for me to get into because I'm not a skinny girl. I'm not a super tall girl. I'm not short. I'm 5'6" and a half. Mm-hmm. But I wasn't the height that I was told was required of it. And so I didn't have the body. I didn't have the height. And that's all I knew about it. And so I just kind of left that dream to the side. And as I met Jay Bolin over the past few years, we've just had a really wonderful relationship. I definitely feel like it's a God connection. He's so awesome, he and his wife, Nicole. And I never told him I wanted to model. I've never told him those dreams of modeling or being a part of beauty products. And he asked me to be the face of his new collection, and I literally, like, broke down in tears. I could not believe that. And it really just shows me that whatever dreams God puts in your heart, do not grow weary in working on them and working towards them, because he will give you the desires of your heart. All you have to do is ask and do the work. And so It was a dream to do that shoot last Saturday. That was absolutely amazing. I could not believe it. I was ready to put on every piece of clothing they had on those racks. And when I tell you, it was hours of changing and smiling and posing. And I had a blast. I would do it again, again, and again. And so that's so exciting. And it just sort of revived that dream. I'm trying to figure out how I can walk in a New York fashion show. I'm so excited about it.
Yeah, I was looking at that like Pastor Greenleaf was looking at Lady May. Oh boy.
Yes, when she came down the stairs, she said, "Where are you going looking like the woman I married?" That was very, very cute.
Very good. That's very good. I was last in Detroit when during the NABJ. I didn't get a chance to talk to you because they were moving you around from place to place, but I was there for the National Association of Black Journalists in Detroit. What is the difference between when you were growing up in Detroit and now? You see any differences or things that are different for the city?
Absolutely. I mean, gentrification for one.
Yeah, absolutely.
And there were so many just kind of abandoned homes. There was so much crime. And I think now, you know, as I continue to go back home and, you know, visit my grandma or my uncles, and or my brother, I see how it's turned around for good in that sense. Not as much crime. The abandoned homes have, you know, been worked on, and they're really trying to build it up to what it used to be before I was born. Detroit is beautiful in so many ways. I love Detroit. Detroiters are resilient. Detroiters are like, yeah, we may be down right now, but we coming back. You know, don't worry about us. And so that's the thing I love about Detroit, and I think that that will never go away. But it is, you know, downtown is really turning into something I never thought it would be. And hopefully it will be great. But I don't want our people to feel like we no longer have a place to go because now Caucasian people see the beauty in it. It was beautiful before you saw the beauty, and now you want to take it over. And so I just think that there's a lot of that we have to face and kind of figure out. But Detroit is, whether or not they continue to build great things there or not, it's a beautiful city. And I always love going home. But yeah, there are some differences.
Yeah. I would be remiss if I didn't ask you about the feedback that you get. It's one thing for me to be a Greenleaf super fan and for us to be able to watch it, as I mentioned, episodically, because we do need 6 days to process it after we watch one episode. what has been the feedback that you received from your family and from the outside about the program from church folk?
You know, well, my parents and my brothers are 100% supporters. They are, and they have been, they totally are excited about what God has done in my life, and they love it. They also understand the art of acting and the magic of TV. And so I don't get a lot from them. I get the wow, you continue to grow every episode. You know, your ability, your art is continuously growing, which is exciting for me because that's all I want. I want to grow from episode to episode, season to season. I constantly want to grow in my art and what it is I'm doing. Church people, I think for the most part, are cool. They're good. It's interesting. I think a lot of people were hesitant because it seemed like it was something that would be negative about the church and something that would that tried to make the church be seen in a bad light. And I think once people started to watch it, they realized that was not the purpose of this show. The church is merely the backdrop of the show. This show is really about a family and the business of running a church of very flawed people, which I think causes you to take a look at anybody, whether it's the leaders in your church, the ushers in your church, whoever, and recognize that we don't serve the leaders. We serve God, and the leaders serve God. And so I think that it has just sort of opened the eyes of some people while also providing a lot of dramatic, fun entertainment. And once people see it, I think that's what they feel. But I think it also starts conversations. I think particularly in the Black community, the Black church community, growing up in that, I feel as though we've done a lot of kind of sweeping things under the rug and not really recognizing that God has created people to deal with a lot of things that we all go through as humans. I think that we felt shame thinking that we needed to talk to a therapist, and it's kind of like, no, you just need to give it to God. Yes, you do need to give it to God. You do need to lay it at the altar, and you do need to talk to someone. God has gifted so many people with an understanding of problems and situations and basic human behavior to help you understand what you're going through and how you can maneuver past it. So it's okay to talk to people, and I think in the Black community, we have felt shame about that because we've felt like we've had to have a certain pride because of how we've been treated as Black people, period. And, you know, we've been treated like we're nothing. And so how dare we look like we need to ask for help? And I think that this has created an opportunity for us to not feel ashamed of anything we've ever had to go through and to not feel like our mistakes define who we are. And to know that we can ask for help and we can rise above and that we are so worthy of the destiny that God has called us to be.
Deborah Joy Winans with Jonathan Hood right here on Under the Hood. Don't forget When I Rose. That's where you can download the song. Wherever you download your music, look for When I Rose. Look for Deborah Joy Winans. Were you a sports fan growing up? Were you a Pistons or Tigers fan or Lions?
Oh, totally. Now, you know, I can't say I'm totally into baseball. I do like eating the hot dogs, but basketball was my jam. I love, especially the Bad Boys. And I grew up, you know, knowing Joe Dumars and Isaiah Thomas and Barry Sanders, you know, when he was still playing with the Lions. I love Barry and his kids. Oh, my goodness. I've been knowing them since I was a little girl. Mm-hmm. And so I loved it. I love sports. I love going to the games. I love, I'm very competitive, and I love shouting at people and hollering for my team and booing the other team. That is very exciting to me. So that's I so love funny. All of it.
It's cathartic just to be able to yell out.
Absolutely. Yes.
I love it. Yes. That's so funny. Well, lastly, and I really, really appreciate your time, Deborah. I'm just wondering from you, is there one thing that you want to do in entertainment, something that you haven't done before that you want to do?
Oh, ooh, that's a good question. I mean, I want to do everything. And I know that sounds crazy, but I really want to do everything. I want to work in film. Not only do I want to be in front of the lens, I want to be behind the lens. I love kind of seeing the whole picture of where things need to go and understanding how to get there, which is really exciting to me. I love theater. I would love to be on Broadway. I love dance. Really, really, really love dance. I grew up taking tap jazz and ballet, and then in some of the shows that I was able to do in undergrad, I got to do the tango, which was so, so fun to me. So I'd love to do something in dance. I love to model. I love to speak. So I would love to be the voice of a really fun, fantastic, feisty character. There's so much that I would love to do in entertainment. But most of all, wherever I go, I want to make sure I'm touching someone, changing someone's life for the better, some way, somehow. And I think that's just in what we do every day and how we treat people every single day. That's where God's going to get the glory. So, yeah, there's so much I want to do, Jonathan. I don't know. There's a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is a lot. And Joy, I just want to let you know that your family, you and your family have been such a blessing to all of us through music and now through television. It's just great. It's just
Thank
great.
You.
I'm just
Thank
I'm so
you.
Glad you spent some time with me.
Thank you for having me. I love spending time with great people. And Jonathan, you are a great, great person. Very interesting, very fun, very real. So thank you for having me.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And we want you to download, not you, Deborah, you don't have to do this. I'm talking to the audience when I say, don't download. I'm talking to the audience when I say, we want you to download When I Rose, wherever you download your music. That's
yes.
where you could find it. Yeah, that you. I'm sure you've downloaded it. I'm talking to the audience. You.
I have.
You. See, radio is really strange because I'm talking to you. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to the royal you, like everybody that's listening, the thousands that are listening to the show. So you get it.
Yes. Absolutely. I absolutely get it. And I will download with all of you.
Yes, you. Thank you. Thank you. When I Rose, that's the music that you download. Look for Deborah Joy Winans and download that many, many times. As always, I appreciate it and looking forward to more episodes of Greenleaf. Continued success.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. And don't hate me too bad as you watch the show.
Okay. Well, there's a tease right there, everybody.
Yes, it is.
You're listening to Under the Hood Podcast with Jonathan Hood.
What a great conversation with Deborah Joy Winans, Charity Greenleaf Satterley on the show Greenleaf on the OWN Network. Let's bring in Sean Davis, the executive producer of the Under the Hood Podcast. Can I tell you something? I love you, Davis, and here's why I love you. You've given me a Christmas gift before Christmas. How are you giving Christmas gifts out on September 27th as we record this?
And it was a beautiful bow, wasn't it?
What a bow it was, let me tell you. let me tell you, this was it's got to be one of my favorite interviews of the year because it's a show that you and I both watch, number one. And number two, ultimately, Deborah Joy Winans is really the ultimate reason why I watch, quite frankly. I mean, if you've seen her,
I can amazing. Second that motion.
Yeah, absolutely. Come on now. You've seen the show. What'd you think of what she had to say? She is as entertaining and as loose, because obviously on the show she's not, but in that interview she was great, wasn't she?
As authentic as a guest as we've ever had, probably, on the podcast and the show. I mean, she's just genuine.
I'll ask you. Being around people from the church folk, how many church folk watch Greenleaf? Because you can imagine, as I asked her, you know, what is the kind of, what is the thoughts from people when they see this? Because on the show Greenleaf, it really talks a lot about the business of the church, which is a part of the church, is no question. I've been there, so I know that you are concerned about how you're able to keep the lights on, making sure that it's warm in the winter and it's cool in the summer. You want to make sure that everyone's comfortable. You want to be able to raise money to be able to build a church. That's not ultimately the bottom line of the church, but I'm wondering what other people say to you about the show that they watch.
Well, depending upon who I talk to, a lot of people love it. They love the portrayal and the truth that comes forth, because a lot of people just love the honesty about the writing. Deborah Joy Winans talked about the showrunner and the great job that the writer does in developing stories and gave the example. You gave the example of her story and the development with her there. And then you have people on the other hand, and I won't even go by age or anything like that, but there are a lot of people I talk to that want all of that stuff to stay in the dark. And they don't want a scene, and they don't want to see anything that might give a negative portrayal, shall I say, of the church itself. So No, it goes both ways.
Yeah, I and someone that's been around the church for a long time, you can, I mean, she's with BB and CC Winans, of course. She mentioned off the air that her grandmother is, she hadn't seen the show, but she read the description of the show, Davis, and she was like, nah, we're not doing that. She's like, I'm not watching that, because she doesn't want anything negative to be out on television on a weekly basis about the church.
Yeah.
And I get
it. Yeah, they don't.
Yeah.
And like I said, I don't want to make an age theme, because I believe there are younger people that also feel the exact same way. But I think just understanding that there is strength from acknowledging some of the pitfalls and some of the flaws, it can only make us better.
Well, I appreciate my Christmas gift early, and you don't have to give me anything, because that's fine.
I just
wanted
to present it to you correctly. As long as you're happy, I'm happy.
Yeah. Well, that's something, man. She was delightful. She really was. So Sean Davis has covered the Christmas gift for 2019 and 2020 by booking Deborah Joy.
Well, I get a waiver for next year as well.
Yeah, man. Yeah. You can't do no wrong, man. You walk on water now.
I got out the boat, huh? I'm walking to you, Jesus.
Yeah. You can't deny you three times. Here, I know who you are, because you got me Deborah Joy Winans. you've done it before the cock crows, so I appreciate that. Thank you very much. Well,
good looking. I like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, what a great conversation with Deborah Joy Winans. Share this conversation, by the way, if you get an opportunity. Share this podcast for those that are a fan of the Winans or a fan of the show Greenleaf. Share this show, and don't forget our YouTube page as well, youtube.com. Look for Under the Hood with Jonathan Hood. We have some interviews that you might have missed. It's on our YouTube page. It's in the description of this podcast as well. So thanks so much, as always, for your support. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter, twitter.com, tweetjhood. Also on Instagram, IGJHood. The executive producer of the Under the Hood podcast is Sean Davis. And we will talk to you next time with another thrilling conversation. Won't be as good as this one, I'll tell you right now. I'm going to need a cigarette after this. But it will be another conversation we'll have right here on the Under the Hood podcast.